Good morning.
Good morning, Pastor Butch.
I'd like to welcome you to Zwingli United Church of Christ for those who are here as well as those who are on Facebook live stream. Just a reminder that if you're here to fill out your welcome sheets at the end of your rows, pass those along to your neighbors. And for those on Facebook live stream, please register if you can, or at least put your name in the chat. That would be wonderful. Do have a few thank yous this morning. It's great to have Jonathan Kracht with us. And so thanks, Jonathan, for being here and for that beautiful piece that you just played. And also thank you to Angela Mosby and also to Pam Myers, who will be participating in the worship service today. And as always, the musicians, thank you for all that you've been doing the past few weeks and for today as well. Have a few prayer requests to share with you this morning. Prayers for the family, and just to let you know that I'll be using just first names, not last names, and that's going to be a new practice for us. It was my fault that the explanation did not get into the bulletin, so the explanation will come next week as to why we're doing this, but just to let you know, that's how we're going to be handling prayer requests on Sunday morning. So prayers for the family of Ray, who died this past week, especially for his wife, Linda, and their daughters, Tara Kay, and family. Tara and her family are members at Zwingli, and for their other daughter, Shannon, and for all those who knew and loved Ray. Also, I learned yesterday that Margaret, 97 years old, was on hospice care, and she passed away peacefully yesterday. And prayers especially for her daughter, Jane, and son, Bob, as well as for Rich and for Kate, the granddaughter who we support as a missionary to Brazil, just for all of the family touched by her loss. Then we also have prayers of healing and recovery for Lois, who had surgery on Friday related to cancer. Things went well. She texted me Friday afternoon, you know, knowing Lois, it couldn't have been someone else, but it was Lois who texted me. And so things went well. She said, they're still awaiting results regarding staging and next steps. So continued prayers for Lois and for Lee and for all those who are helping her out. Also, prayers for the families of Mickey and Valerie. Valerie's mom passed away from lung cancer at the end of June, and Mickey's dad just passed away last week. They're good friends of Monica and Chris, and their kids have grown up together, so that's pretty young to be losing loved ones, especially parents. And so prayers for Mickey and Valerie and all the family. And also prayers for Nick and his family as Chris and Mike and Jess move Nick into skilled nursing today. And so that's going to be quite the adjustment. And so for everyone, especially for Nick, so prayers for them. And also prayers for Pastor Allen and his family, who I believe are returning home today in one way or the other. I'm not sure of their itinerary or how all that's happening, but Pastor Allen will be back into the office on Tuesday. And so just prayers for the family and traveling mercies. So those are all the prayers to offer today. And if you have any prayer requests, please feel free to email, text, however you want to get in touch with Pastor Allen or myself, or you can also send them to the church office. So now, having heard all of these prayer requests, let us now prepare our hearts and our minds and our souls for worship. For those who are able, please stand for the call to worship. Just as the heavens burst forth in praise to God,
we celebrate God's abundant and powerful love.
Day by day and night by night,
God watches over us, loving and healing us.
Come, celebrate with joy the love of God.
Open our hearts and spirits, Lord, and teach us your ways. Amen.
Good morning. Let us pray. Loving and caring God, we come this morning seeking wisdom and guidance for all our lives. Open us to your words of life and truth. In this time of worship, help us more fully understand what it means to be a disciple, a follower of your way of Jesus, a follower of the path of service. May the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Let us pray for transformation and new life, followed by a silent confession. Lord, it is easy for us to say that we will follow you, but then you turn your backs and act as though our commitment to you does not mean anything to us. Jesus challenges us to take up our crosses, and when we don't understand what that means, we just shrug and turn away. Forgive us for our lack of commitment and faith. Heal us of our greed and fears. Give us courage to be disciples and enable us to joyfully proclaim your healing mercies and your transformational love. God so loved the world that God's Son was sent to us. In sending Jesus Christ, God offers a model and companion, a source of ever-flowing love and acceptance and grace. In Christ, we are forgiven all our failings and given strength to start again. Amen.
It is good to gather here in the Spirit of God. It is good to gather here in the peace of Christ. And so I say to you, the peace of Christ be with you.
Also with you.
Let us share a sign of Christ's peace with one another.
You're back to school? You like your new teacher? Good. Do you like your... Anyway, look at this. You know what this is?
Cards.
Cards. Yes. They're rather old cards, but they're cards. That works. Okay. Now, I need a helper. Who would like to be my helper? Okay. All right. I want you to pick a card out of here, any card, and don't let me see it. Okay? All right, now you can show it to, you can show it around. You can show it to everybody, but don't let me see it. You can show everybody out there in the audience. Okay? All right, now I'd like you to take it, stick it back in the middle someplace. Okay. Now, this is going to be magic. This is going to be really neat. You ready?
Okay.
1, 2, 3. There we go. There's your card, right?
Yeah.
Is that the card?
No.
No. It's supposed to be. I bought a book. I bought a magic book and everything and said, just do that. But there was all a bunch of other stuff too, but I forgot. That was too complicated, so I didn't bother with that. Anyway, I should have known better. I'm not really very good at that. But anyway, cool. Life's not always that easy either, is it? Sometimes you have problems. You have to do all kinds of things you don't want to do. Life's hard sometimes. Not for her.
Sometimes it's hard for her.
Oh, is it?
2 a.m.
I know, that's your sister.
Yeah, that, I was going to pull my hair if I keep sitting here.
She's going to pull your hair? Well, don't let her do that. Anyway, things in life aren't very easy. You know, Jesus was talking to his disciples one day, and he was telling them that he was going to be made fun of and put up on a cross and crucified and died, but then he was going to rise again and hopefully take sins away from the people. And Peter said, no, you don't have to go through all that. No, you're the king of earth. You have the power to just set up your kingdom right here on earth. You don't have to go through all that pain and suffering. But Jesus said, no, Peter, you don't understand. This is not what God sent me here for. God sent me here to help take sins away from people. So we can't take the easy way. We have to take the hard way. And if you want to follow Jesus, it's not easy. It's not easy. You've got to do things that are sometimes very, very difficult. Okay. Are you ready to pray with me? Okay. Will you pray with me? Father, help us to be willing to take up our cross and follow Jesus. We know it won't be easy, but it will be worth it. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
This morning our reading comes from Psalm 19, verses 7 through 14. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey, and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned, in keeping them there is great reward. But who can detect their errors? Clear me from the hidden faults. Keep back your servant also from the insolent. Do not let them have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgressions. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
So our gospel lesson this morning is found in the gospel according to Mark in the 8th chapter, beginning with the 27th verse. Jesus went on with the disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist," and others said, "Elijah," and still others, "one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And Jesus sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said all of this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will gain it. And what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." May God add a blessing to the hearing and also the reading of God's word. So I read somewhere that this gospel passage today is at the midpoint of the gospel according to Mark. Now, whether that's true or not, I'm not sure, but what does happen there is that it's a hinge. It's a critical point in the gospel when things begin to shift. Things have been going along pretty well, and then Jesus comes up with the disciples, and although it's a little too early in school for midterms, in the passage today, it's almost like a midterm for the disciples. Jesus wants to ask them, "So, you know, what's going on here? How do people, you know, think about me? How do you think about me?" He wants to find out what they're thinking and also wants to tell them what's expected of them. And so he asks two important questions and then gives them a new teaching and then a statement to ponder, not just a statement, but a concrete action for them to do. So this morning, we're going to be thinking a little bit about these questions as well. Now, we haven't done this in a while, and the way that you guys responded to someone saying good morning over here, I'm a little worried about asking you questions, because they said good morning, and I heard, "Good morning." So I'm hoping that you'll answer questions a little bit better, that you'll think about these questions, and they're questions that you've already heard, and hopefully questions that you've thought about as well. So the first question is the very first question that Jesus asked the disciples. Who do people say that I am? So I want you to answer the question, who do you think that people out in the world think Jesus is? So think about what people in the world, as you've been able to observe, as you've read in the paper, as you've seen what's going on in our country, in our community, in your neighborhoods, who do you think people believe Jesus to be? And if that's too hard a question to answer, then what do people believe the church to be? So you can answer either one of them. Who do you think other people believe Jesus to be? Or what do you think people believe the church to be? And don't be shy. There are no stupid answers. Believe me, I've given enough of them myself and I can't call them stupid. And so there's no, please, whatever you think. Yeah. So some people think that Jesus is condemning and that the church is condemning and judgmental. I think that's exactly right. What else? Yes. Right. So some people say the church just wants my money, which we actually do. The church just wants our money, and they just want us to help out without really giving much in return, I guess, or whatever they might think around that. So the church just wants my money. They're always asking for money. I think that's also something that people hear, too. Yeah, Sherry.
A lot of people think the church has a community.
A lot of people think of the church as a community and one that helps others as well. Yeah.
Some people think that Jesus is a myth.
Some people think that Jesus is a myth, not a real person, just an example that's been thought up by other people and just not real at all. Okay. Yes, Katie.
Some people think that Jesus is their leaders.
That Jesus what?
Is their leaders. Like, they are
certain. Oh, so some people see Jesus and think that they are, that Jesus is our political leader?
Leaders.
Leaders, okay. Okay, so or yeah. So some people, actually, I think some people see some of our leaders as Messiah-like, right? Okay, now we're getting somewhere. Okay. And thank you for being the answer on this side. Just saying. Yes, Dale, I knew I'd get you.
Some people think Jesus is Caucasian.
Some people think Jesus is Caucasian, yeah. Okay. Which she's not, right? Right. Anything else? Yes. Yes. Flo.
Some people think the church is a God-free community. The old generation, for example, and the younger generation may even ask the question as to what's it in for me.
Okay. So some people believe that the church is the rock for the community, and then some people will also ask, what's in it for me? And I think that's a really interesting statement, because the studies are now showing that in the past, the church used to be seen as one of the trusted institutions, and that institutions were a place where people could come, they can form community, and they didn't think about what's in it for me, but how could we be a part of this community? Whereas now, things have shifted, and people begin to look at what's important for me, because they've lost trust in institutions. And there's a lot that goes into that. So there might be people who are asking, what's in it for me? Which is a different question than, what does it mean to be part of a community, right? Yes, Dale. Oh, I'm sorry. Right. So there's different ways of looking who Jesus is, a lot of flavors of the Christian church, and that's exactly right. If you look at just the denominations alone in the United States, there's a lot of different ways of looking at faith and looking at Jesus. And so some of them then also attach who they are to who Jesus is, right? And so that's a mistake. I think we need to let Jesus be who Jesus is. I mean, we need to put some interpretation in there, but I think it's important then to think about how we often will say, oh, well, Jesus represents me or us and not them. Yeah. Yes, Kathy.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So Kathy says that there's a lot of distrust in the church because many people will twist the message of Jesus or what Jesus does or what we read about in the scripture to fit their own needs. And sometimes they twist it so much that Jesus becomes unrecognizable. She didn't say that, but I am. That sometimes Jesus seems unrecognizable. I think there's some things going on in the Christian church right now where folks talk about power and talk about all kinds of other things that go along with power, and I'm not sure if they're quite getting at least the Jesus I read about in the Bible. So, yeah. Yes, Michael.
Yeah, and that's been going on for thousands of years. Yep. Where Jesus has been used to justify the mercy you can imagine.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, so Michael is reminding us it's not a new thing. It's been going on for thousands of years. In the Crusades, the cross was right in front of everyone who then went out and did some really horrible, atrocious things. And so we continue to do that kind of thing, using Jesus and sort of not just adopting Jesus, but kind of using Jesus as the person that's allowing us to do the things that we want to do, even though they might very well be against what Jesus would want us to do or think about or act, how we act in the world. Oh, sorry, Obi.
On that same theme that occurs to me, you don't have to go back to Rome. Just remember the battle hymn of the Republic.
Yep.
You know, the United States has used Jesus in war.
Yeah, so the battle hymn of the Republic, how the United States has coerced Jesus into being used for things that I don't think Jesus would be real happy about. So I think it's really interesting when we think about what it means to be a Christian nation, which I'm not sure if that's the best way to go about our Christianity. I think what we need to think about is what does it mean to be Christian, and how do I live that out in the country that I'm living in? And then how does what we do affect other people as well? So, yeah. So people are concerned about the hypocrisy that exists in the church, of which there is quite a bit. But I can tell you there's a lot of hypocrisy everywhere. And people who have good causes and yet find a way down a path that they really shouldn't go. And people see that. That's one of the reasons why we come together, I think, is so that we can learn about, talk about what it means to be a follower of Jesus, so that we can make sure that we're showing what God wants us to show. Yes, there'll be times where we'll make mistakes. There'll be times when we might not get it just right, but at least we're doing our very best to try to make sure that we're following in the way of Jesus, which in many ways is pretty clear, and in other ways we kind of scratch our heads and we struggle, but that's a good thing. I said last week, it's good to struggle with that. It's better to struggle with that than to turn your backs on it. All right, these have been great answers, and we could go, one more answer. Yeah, Rich will have the last word on this question. Better be right. No. So the church is, church has a mission, should have a mission to help. So it's really interesting to hear all of these different answers, right? That the church is actually reflective of our humanity, right? That the church does some really wonderful things, and we as human beings do really wonderful things as well. Sometimes in the name of God, sometimes just because we do. And you also do other things that aren't so great. And that's what happens in the church. Many times we will get things right and other times we'll get things wrong. But hopefully we're trying to move towards that place where we listen to Scripture, we listen to the Spirit, we listen to one another as long as we're trying to be faithful to the path. And that's what we try to do on a Sunday morning, like what we're doing right now or in any other Sunday morning. So I have another question for you that comes straight from Scripture. Who do you say that Jesus is? I don't want to hear what you think the church is, necessarily. I want to hear, who do you believe Jesus to be for you?
Go right
to
the catechism.
Go right.
Go right to the catechism, I can't remember the line. Jesus, my Lord,
so I know what you're talking about. I didn't do the Heidelberg Catechism, so I don't know the answers to those two questions, nor do I actually know the two questions. So all the people in the UCC and the Reformed area here are probably wanting to get rid of me as a UCC pastor. But I don't know the Heidelberg Catechism, and some people, though, can recite it just like that. Anyone recite the Heidelberg Catechism, the first two questions? No. No, that's the Apostles' Creed. Yeah, there's two specific questions of the Heidelberg Catechism for those who were brought up in it can still recite to this day. And it talks essentially about God being their comfort and strength and, you know, essentially their main purpose. And so I think now we're all going to be kicked out of the UCC. But I think that's one of the ways you look at Jesus. You learn about Jesus through some of those things you learned, including the Apostles' Creed, or the Nicene Creed, or some of the other statements of faith that we use. What I like to do is learn from the youth and some of the statements of faith that they've come up with, which have been just actually pretty profound. And so not to say bad things about the Apostles' Creed, which was great too, but we learned about who Jesus is through the creeds. Yeah. Yes, Katie, who do you believe? I'm sorry? For you, yes. So Jesus is a teacher and a role model. So that's one of those, some of the things that we absolutely say about Jesus as many times as we can, that Jesus is a teacher. He was a rabbi, right? He was called rabbi, teacher. And so he is a teacher in so many ways on so many levels. But he's also a model that's really hard to follow. But Jesus is a model of how we are to live our lives in relationship with God. Yes, Dale. Jesus is a true moral compass. Okay. I really wish we had a Jesus compass, you know, like one that, you know, that showed you true north and all that stuff, you know, and you can, if you know how to read it, then you can actually find your way around. It would be really nice. In some ways, we have the Bible, we have scripture, we have other people who have written about Jesus and about faith, and that helps us as well. But it would be really nice to have that, like, answer all the time. But we don't, and so this is what we do. We try to figure it out together. Yes, Jonathan.
As we walk around Main Street in Sourdough, we look at our signs and they show individuals who made the ultimate sacrifice. And as we walk up and down Main Street, we can see the emblems of those who have served and made the ultimate sacrifice. When I think of Christ, I think of the individual who made
So this is a really, so we can walk down the streets of Souderton or in some other communities around and you can see the faces and names of people who made the ultimate sacrifice, whether it was in the war in Vietnam or World War II or whatever it might be. So Jonathan says that when he thinks about Jesus, he thinks of Jesus as indeed making the ultimate sacrifice. So to take that analogy a little bit further, are we then going to be his banners? Are we going to be the ones who show who Jesus is to the world, right? So what we think, some people have said that your theology or the way you think about Jesus or how you would answer this question says a lot about what kind of Christian you're going to be. So the way we answer this question about who is Jesus for me or for us says a lot about how we're going to live our lives as Christians. So, for example, if Jesus is your teacher, what are you going to do to learn as much as you possibly can for how Jesus is teaching us to live life? How are you going to do as much as you possibly can to listen intently to all the things that happen in worship, not just during the sermon, because sometimes a sermon might not be very good. But I can tell you, as I've said before, there are many sermons preached during a worship service. And I hope that you're being attentive to the words. Even if you're not singing during a hymn or during a song, I hope you're paying attention to the words because there are sermons in there and good ones. And so not only should we be singing that with as much energy as we can, we should also be turning that back into our hearts and learning something about what it means to be a faithful person, a faithful follower of Jesus. Anyone else? Who is Jesus for you? Yes.
Jesus is my strength. I don't think you can do anything without any more strength.
Yeah. So Jesus is my strength, and I don't know if I can do anything if I can't lean on that strength. And I think that's exactly right. If you talk to a lot of people from this church, those who have gone on before, those who are still with us, and to hear about the things that they have gone through, knowing they had their faith and their faith in Jesus helped them to get through. We talked about Margaret. She passed away on Friday. Her husband was diagnosed with Alzheimer's and lived for 20 years with Alzheimer's. And she was daily faithful to going to see him and to make sure that he was cared for. And she didn't allow that to make herself bitter or allow herself to say, oh, well, this is the cross I have to bear. I don't have to do anything else. That's not what she did. And so just that example alone is just something that's really incredible. And she was able to do that because she could lean on her faith. And she could lean on that community that many of you have talked about. Yes. Or in the baby, yeah.
He's a perfect example of humanity at its best. So when he's angry, it's righteous. When he's sorrowful, there's reason for it.
So I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to repeat this exactly, so forgive me. Since he is both holy God and holy human, he is the best example of what it truly means to be human in all aspects of what that means. And so you use the example of when it's anger, it's righteous anger. So we've talked about before where anger can be a good thing. Anger doesn't necessarily need to be bad. It's what you do with the anger that makes it something that's not very good. But sometimes anger is necessary. Jesus turned the tables over. Jesus did a number of things. And so a righteous anger, all the way to the joys, all the way to the healing, you know, all the other things we think about with Jesus. But he was fully human. And because of that, he can certainly be the example or the model for us to follow. Thank you. Yes. Jesus for you is the hope of eternal life. And so one of the things we proclaim as Christians is the resurrection. And that because of that resurrection, that's a door for us. That's an opening for us to be able to spend eternal life with God, to be embraced face to face with the God that loves us. So eternal life. And that eternal life doesn't need to be just in the future. That eternal life can also exist in some way, maybe an imperfect way, but in some way here with us now. We can touch on that eternal life right now. So it is something that is now and to come. Any others? Yes. So Jesus is the same, but you have a different view of Jesus as you go throughout your life. And I think that's one of the ways in which we mature as Christians. And hopefully we do that through different kinds of ways, like prayer, like we've talked about before, listening to God, talking with Jesus, making sure that we do whatever we can to figure out that relationship in different ways. I would push back a little bit, and I would say that God and Jesus do change. So if you remember the scripture last week where the woman came up to him who was a Syrophoenician woman, and she said, you know, please heal my daughter. And he says to her, you know, why should I give the food that's for the children of God to dogs? And so some people would say in that particular moment, in that particular exchange, there was something about Jesus's view of what he was about that changed. And so I'm not sure how that works with the divine. I know that that's something that's really hard to talk about or to say that actually happens. But in some ways, if you're in a relationship, there's got to be some change, right? If we talk about a relationship, I hope that when we're in a relationship with our spouses or our kids or whoever it might be, that those relationships don't stay stagnant all the time, that just one person stays the same all the time and someone else has to change around them. I don't see that as a relationship. And maybe I'm completely wrong about this, but I believe that there's some sense of where Jesus and God also change, and how that happens, I'm not sure. We had an example of it last week in Scripture, where all of a sudden we saw Jesus open up to something entirely different. And so, I don't know. But I think there's some essential aspects that we need to hold on to as always unchanging. And that's where we get into big disagreements in the Christian faith. What is that thing that does not change? Yeah. Any others? Wow, you guys. Oh, okay.
Friend and confidant.
Friend and confidant. Yes. So many times when you can't rely on anyone else, or you're not sure if you can tell anyone or someone else something that's really on your heart, you can turn to Jesus. Because Jesus can take it all. Can take your anger, can take your joy, can take your frustration, can take your decision-making, all of it. All of it can be laid at the foot of the cross. What I love about the cross as it is now is it used to be up on that wall behind that wall. It used to be stagnant in some ways on the wall. And so we had to decide where to put this. And you've heard this story before. And I got a call from Earl Ludwig about where to put the cross. And I said, well, Earl, I trust you. Just put it, you know, where you think it should go. And so Earl and whoever was with him that day put the cross right there. And what was amazing about that is after the fire, there were people from the conference who came here, and many of you, again, have heard this story, that came here and got in a circle towards the back of what the sanctuary was then and prayed for Zwingli. It was a powerful moment. And when I came in, I realized the cross was right in the middle of that circle. That cross was placed without Earl or anyone else knowing about that moment, because I brought the people in secretly from the conference to pray, not secretly, they just came in, but no one really knew about it. And all of a sudden, the cross is right there where we prayed. So that's one of the things I think is really important about what it means to believe in Jesus, to understand how things might change in your relationship, to also understand how Jesus works with us, and Jesus shows us signs, and Jesus does so many other things so that we can be the community we are right now, today, as well as a community that God is calling us to be in the future. So that's what Jesus is also doing for us as well. Jesus is calling us to be the church, not only now, but in the future, which will be different than what we're looking at now. It might be challenging to be the church in the future, because there's a lot of things shifting in our culture to which we must respond, and which we need to use our faith to make sure we respond, to make sure that we are continually faithful and drawing others to the faith in the best way that we can. You've been a good class today. I would give all of you A's. Well, except for you. No, I think the point isn't necessarily to make the A, because we won't always have the answers. The point is to be there in the class, right? The point is to make sure that you're not afraid of the questions Jesus may ask of you or the directions that Jesus may be taking you. And not only you personally, but us as a congregation. But as long as we're communicating with one another, that we're praying with one another, that we're worshiping with one another, that we're singing with one another, you know, the one who sings prays twice, is what Augustine said. As long as we're doing these things together, then we can find the way of Jesus in our lives today and the lives that God is calling us to in the future. May it be so. May we continue to be this community of faith, unafraid to ask questions, unafraid to answer questions, unafraid to succeed, and unafraid to fail. Because Jesus is seen in all of that, in the suffering, in the success, in all of the stuff that we do. And for that, we give thanks. Amen. Now let us affirm our faith together. We believe in God, the eternal Spirit, who is made known to us in Jesus our brother, and to whose deeds we testify. God calls the worlds into being, creates humankind in the divine image, and sets before us the ways of life and death. God seeks in holy love to save all people from aimlessness and sin. God judges all humanity and all nations by that will of righteousness declared through prophets and apostles. In Jesus Christ, the man of Nazareth, our crucified and risen Lord, God has come to us and shared our common lot, conquering sin and death, and reconciling the whole creation to its creator. God bestows upon us the Holy Spirit, creating and renewing the Church of Jesus Christ, binding in covenant faithful people of all ages, tongues, and races. God calls us into his church to accept the cost and joy of discipleship, to be his servants in the service of the whole human family, to proclaim the gospel to all the world and resist the powers of evil, to share in Christ's baptism and eat at his table, to join him in his passion and victory. God promises to all who trust in the gospel forgiveness of sins and fullness of grace, courage in the struggle for justice and peace, the presence of the Holy Spirit in trial and rejoicing, and eternal life in that kingdom which has no end. Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto God. Please be seated. And let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, as we come together as this community of faith, we give you thanks. We give you thanks especially for your presence. We give you thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, who came to us to teach us, to show us how to live, but also to save us, to be the one who has come that we might be reconciled to you, that we might be forgiven our sins, so that we too can do the things that you have called us to do, to forgive others, to be compassionate, to reach out, to do those things you've called us to do so people will be less confused about what the church is supposed to be all about, that we make sure that we show your love. Oh God, we ask you to help us to continue to learn and to pray and to worship and to fellowship with one another and to do all of those things to strengthen the bonds of Christian fellowship together and to reach out to all those that you called us to minister to and with. As we come together today, oh God, we have many concerns on our heart for those who have lost their lives, for their families, for those who are dealing with recovery, with all the things that might be going on in people's lives today. So we pray especially for the family of Ray, that you'll be with them and as they deal with their loss and as they struggle with what that means for their lives. Be with them as they gather together later this week for a memorial service. Help them, O God, as they grieve to continually turn to you, to know that you will be there when they most need you. We also pray for the family of Margaret, who passed away peacefully yesterday, and so thankful for her life of 97 years, so thankful for her family, and they love, they share with one another, and that they shared with her, and that she gave back to them. We thank you, O God, for her, and that she was indeed a good and faithful servant. But be with them in their days ahead as they grieve, as they feel sadness. And even though they feel joy for her life today, we know that that loss will have an effect, and be with them in those times. We also pray this day for the families of Mickey and Valerie, for the loss of Valerie's mom and Mickey's father. Again, help them, O God, be with them. Let them know of your presence. And if they can't feel your presence directly, that your presence be shared with them through others that care for them and that love them. Oh God, we also pray this day for Lois, that she'll be with her during her recovery and healing. We are thankful that the surgery went well. We are thankful for the doctor who did the surgery and others who helped out with that, who assisted. We are thankful that she has a loving family and a loving husband in Lee. We are thankful for her faith, a faith I know that keeps her going forward. We ask you, O God, to continue to be with her as she heals. We also pray this day for Nick and for his family as well, making this transition to skilled nursing, knowing that will not necessarily be an easy transition, but one that is necessary right now, that you'll be with Nick, that he'll know, again, the love and the care of his family, and the love and the care of those here in this church, the love and care of so many who may know him. Be with him, O God, as he continues his journey of life. And again, we are thankful for the ways in which he has shared his life. I know that I am thankful for the ways he has shared his life with me. O God, help us to be that kind of person that we can share our life with others, that they'll be touched by that grace that you give to us when we're in relationship. And we also pray this day for Pastor Allen and for his family, that you'll be with them as they come home and may they arrive safely. For all of these prayers, O God, we know that you hear our prayer, that you gather them into your heart. And help us, O God, as we pray, that we'll also understand that you have called us in this prayer to reach out to those who might be in need. And so we pray these things, O God, in your name, in the name of your Son, Jesus, who also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We have talked this morning about who Jesus is for us. And this is the church in which we celebrate and practice our faith. And so now in this time of giving, may we think about, reflect on, and also give so that the ministry that God has called us to can be a ministry that is vital, a ministry that is for the world that God loves.
Don't need my name carved in stone.
us go to God in prayer. O God, we hear and respond to your words of wisdom, your words of call and life. May these gifts of not only our money, but of our very selves, our words, our thoughts, our actions, be acceptable to you and help spread your life and love. We pray these things in your name. Amen. Please be seated. All right, so because you're such a great class, the class has gone over. I apologize for that. And so that doesn't mean you have an excuse to miss the next class, which is Adult Electives, for those of you who can stay and go to it. Katie Farina and Meredith Torres will share their experiences of serving on the Telford Borough Council. Yeah, I hope some juicy stuff's in there. So anyway, they'll be meeting in the parlor with folks who will be there for the class. Hope you can attend. I have a few other announcements I'll try to run through. I'll also ask you to please pay attention to the announcements that are in the bulletin. Next week, we have a guest coming to speak about active shooter and how to deal with that. And that's something, unfortunately, is important in our life today. And so if you can attend that, I think the more people who can, the better, that will know about what it means to deal with that kind of situation. And so there will be next week a class on active shooter training and what we should do. Also, the yard sale next Saturday. You can see the announcements in the bulletin about that. I hear that the room is pretty packed full. I'm not quite sure where else to go with them except maybe the Family Life Center, but I know saying that is might get me in trouble, but I think that's okay, right? So if you need to bring other stuff, you can put it in the Family Life Center. Also, the last summer social is today. You can see information about that at Bishop Winery, Bishop Estates Winery. So if you want to attend that, information's there about that. All right, the debt-free celebration next week, next Sunday. We need to have sign-ups so that they can see who's going to be coming and so they can make sure they prepare well enough for who will be there. So if you're going to be coming to the debt-free celebration, please sign up on the bulletin board. I think it's the one nearest the doors so that folks will know that you're coming. Or if you forget to do that on the way out, please email Lisa and say, please put our names up there on the sign-up sheet. And the last thing is, even though we don't always ask for money, we actually need to ask for money because just take a look at the financial situation that we're in right now. If there's any way that you can help out, do a little bit extra, that's great. I know not everyone can, and some people absolutely cannot, but if there's any way that you can help with that deficit, that would be a wonderful thing. And so those are all the announcements to share with you this morning. Again, please pay attention to all the things going on at Zwingli. Very, very active and a lot of activities to be a part of. So our last song is songbook number 116, His Eye is on the Sparrow.
Jesus.
We are called this day to answer the questions each and every day that Jesus poses to his disciples. We are called this day also to take up our cross and follow. And as we come to understand who Jesus is to us, we will come to understand what that truly means for our lives. So as we go out into the world, as we go out to be the disciples of Christ that we are called to be, may the grace of God be with us. May the presence of Christ, the questions of Christ be with us. And may the Holy Spirit inspire us that we will indeed be Christ's disciples in the world. Amen.